Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bay Curious, Exploring the Hidden True Stories of the San Francisco Bay Area, by Olivia Allen Price. Narrated by Olivia Allen Price. For Sullivan, the most curious little dude I know. Introduction. On a summer day in 2013, I found myself hurtling across the Bay Bridge in an airport shuttle van. Just an hour earlier, I'd arrived at Oakland Airport on a flight from Baltimore, ready to start a new life in San Francisco. In the back of the van sat my giant duffel bag, bulging with the mountain of clothing I brought along for my fresh start, a work wardrobe of crisp button-ups and pencil skirts, several pairs of high heels, and many, many pairs of shorts. Virtually all of these items, I would soon learn, are entirely useless here in San Francisco. The driver turned off at the Treasure Island exit, ready to drop off another passenger. And that's when I first saw it. Downtown San Francisco. Lit like a painting in the fading light of the day, aglow in peaches, pinks, baby blues. So striking that the tourists in the van were begging the driver to stop so they could capture it with their cameras. I'll never forget standing on that Treasure Island sidewalk with the sounds of the bay waters lapping at the jagged rocky shore beneath me. As I stared across the bay at this big, beautiful, mysterious city, I thought, my new home. And then, I really need a jacket. I moved to San Francisco to take a job in the newsroom at KQED, one of the nation's largest public media stations. By day, I ran their social media accounts and produced news stories for the website. My nights and weekends were all mine, and honestly, it was kind of a lonely time. I didn't know a soul in the city, so I kept myself busy by walking everywhere. As I hiked miles and miles across the streets of SF, I began to explore the city's distinct neighborhoods and see how one transitioned into the next, how the Western Addition became Civic Center, then the Tenderloin, then Nob Hill. Every nook and cranny of the city vibrated with activity. And along the way, I started to jot down little notes of things that struck me, things to research when I got home, like different styles of Victorian homes, how to play Mahjong, BART expansion. The more I learned about the Bay Area, the more curious I became. How does one even define it? References to the San Francisco Bay Area first showed up on maps in the early 1900s, and opinions about its borders vary. But I like the nine-county definition that comprises Alameda, Contra Costa, Marin, Napa, San Francisco, San Mateo, Santa Clara, Solano, and Sonoma counties. Every question I came up with would lead to 10 more. And then late one night, drenched in the blue light of my laptop, several hours deep into reading about the earthquake of 1906, I thought, I can't be the only person who does this. Fast forward 2 years to 2015, when along with my KQED teammates, I launched an occasional radio series called Bay Curious. Inspired by public radio friends at Chicago's WBEZ and their Curious City program, our premise was simple. We'd invite the public to ask questions about the region. Yeah, the same kinds of questions I'd been coming up with on my walks around town, and answer them. And whenever we could, we'd bring the person who asked the question along for the reporting ride. We knew some people would like it. We had no idea how many. After our very first story aired on KQED Public Radio about an abandoned car on Mount Tamalpais, listeners wrote to tell us how thrilled they were to learn the answer to a question that they'd long wondered about. Hundreds of new questions poured in overnight. Why are there ships buried beneath San Francisco? Where did the word hella come from? Why are BART trains so loud? That's when I knew Bay Curious was onto something. Over the years, that small radio series grew into a hugely popular weekly podcast. And in making it, we've met countless people, longtime Bay Area residents, newcomers, and visitors alike, who all share one thing in common, an insatiable love for learning about this captivating region. Somewhere along the way, we lost count of precisely how many questions we've answered. One thing's for sure, by now, the number is up there in the thousands. We've got so much curiosity to share that we've kept expanding the project, creating in-depth online articles, deep dive videos, a newsletter, and a live event series. And now, we bring you the Bay Curious book. In here, you'll find some of our very favorite stories from the podcast, plus a plethora of brand new tales crafted just for this book. As always, every one of these stories is based on a question that came to us from the public. It's a book made with you and for you. A true collective, curious effort. And I hope you enjoy it. People. On Ohlone Land, The First Bay Area Locals, by Daniel Potter, Asal Asanapur, and Olivia Allen Price. In the 18th century, the area from the lower Napa Valley to South Monterey County was one of the most densely populated Native American territories in North America. About 40,000 people belonged to some 40 tribes settled in permanent villages, beside creeks, in lush grasslands and forests, and near the ocean. Euro-American colonizers lumped these distinct tribes into one group and called them Costanoan. Now they're commonly called the Ohlone. There are a few ideas about where the term Ohlone came from. Sometimes people will say that it comes from the name of one of the smaller nations, said Vincent Medina, an Ohlone activist and chef. But we have another explanation for that in our family here in the East Bay. We believe it comes from the Miwok term, which means people of the West. 18th century life for the Ohlone. Though each Ohlone tribe held its own territory, they had similarities in their culture, religion, language, and diet. Native Californians ate a diversity of plants, fish, birds, and animals, said Alan Leventhal, a retired San Jose State University archaeologist and anthropologist who has been working with several Ohlone tribes since 1980 as a tribal ethnohistorian. They hunted deer, antelope, and elk. Fishing was also important to them. Sturgeon in the bay, and steelhead and salmon runs in the river. Shellfish were on the menu too, and remnants of mussels, clams, and oysters have been found in archaeological sites. What they wore depended on the season, occasion, and ceremonial circumstance. You might find women wearing aprons made from tule reeds and deer skin. Many tattooed their chins with dotted designs or parallel lines. Men often went unclothed, though in the winter, they draped themselves in cloaks made of rabbit skins or sea otter pelts. They also wore headdresses adorned with feathers for ceremonial occasions. Families lived in round homes built from a variety of materials, most often tule reeds or tree bark. Elite families had larger homes measuring as much as 20 feet across. Some villages also had a ceremonial structure called a tu'upintak, big enough to hold hundreds of people. These came in handy during multi-tribe gatherings to trade goods, make economic and military alliances, or hold religious ceremonies. Like tribes throughout Central and Northern California, the Ohlone practice kuksu, a religion characterized by ritualistic dances, song, prayer, reenactments of creation time, intertribal feasts, and commemoration of ancestors. Religion itself varied because there were men's songs and dances, and there were women's songs and dances, said Leventhal. There were men healers, and there were women healers. Shell mounds would also have been an important part of many Ohlone villages. At one point, more than 400 stood around the Bay Area. The human-constructed mounds of earth and organic matter sometimes reached taller than 30 feet. They were ceremonial places, community centers, and burial sites, built up layer by layer over thousands of years. More than 500 ancestral remains were found in a shell mound in Coyote Hills Regional Park, which was excavated during the mid-20th century. Many more remains were left in the ground. Fighting for recognition. The once robust Ohlone population was decimated throughout the late 1700s and 1800s by starvation, diseases, and genocide at the hands of colonizers. The conquest was as cruel as it could be. Indians were drawn into the missions, and many of them died either from disease or were killed outright, said Malcolm Margolin, an author and publisher who has written extensively about the Native peoples of California. Survivors had to give up their land and their way of life. The repercussions are still being felt today. When you deal with a population of people that once owned all of the San Francisco Bay, and today there is nothing for them to show for it, the object is not to take out a violin and say, "Poor people," said Alan Leventhal. You have to listen to these people when they say, "We're going to organize and reclaim our sovereign rights as a federally recognized tribe." Many of the known surviving Native American lineages aboriginal to the San Francisco Bay Area have organized into a united tribe called the Muwekma Ohlone Tribe. Though the Muwekma Ohlone were once recognized by the U.S. government as the Verona Band of Alameda County, they were removed from the list of eligible tribal communities in need of land in 1927, along with 134 other landless California Indian bands and tribes. The Sacramento superintendent with the Bureau of Indian Affairs made the decision, saying their numbers had dwindled to the point that the group was extinct. He wrote in his report, "It does not appear at the present time that there is need for the purchase of land for the establishment of their homes." Since then, Muwekma Ohlone's 600 members have spent decades petitioning to regain their federally recognized status, a designation that comes with benefits like housing, medical care, access to higher education, and the ability to establish a land trust. Currently, none of the Ohlone tribes have regained their recognition by the federal government. "These tribes have been running for their lives," said Leventhal. "These are the last generations that can make strong linkages to their heritage. They can't afford to live in the Bay Area. Unless this next generation of Native American children can make some sizable salaries when they grow up, they will continue to be relegated as a landless tribe. So they are slowly radiating away from the Bay Area." An Ohlone resurgence. "Our family experienced a lot of hardships that came with colonization, too many hardships to ever really list," Vincent Medina says. Through it all, indigenous people like Medina's great-grandmother quietly preserved and passed on the traditions of their ancestors. When not everything could be carried on, one way that our family found to keep these things alive was through documenting them, Medina said. His great-grandmother and other elders wrote thousands of pages on their history, language, religion, and food with several anthropologists and linguists. "My great-grandmother survived that time," Medina said. "She got through it, and she still kept our culture close, passing on as much as she could to everybody in our family around her." And through those efforts, that's how so many of us, including myself, grew up empowered with our culture. Medina says at one point not a single person he knew spoke Chechenyo, his ancestral language. But over the past several years, he and others have worked to resuscitate it, using the documentation their elders left behind as a guide. Now a whole community is conversant. "That shows healing right there in action," Medina says. "That shows how we can be able to have things back again that we might not have had a short time ago, but that we were always meant to have." Medina works to make indigenous culture more visible in other ways, too. He runs Cafe Ohlone, where the menu features shellfish, acorn soup, and even acorn flour brownies, a hit with the kids. He's one person among many working to revive traditional dance, basketry, and even making boats of tule reeds. He sees this as carrying forward a story that began a very, very long time ago. "Knowing that we're indigenous here, that we were created here, it gives us that responsibility and that obligation to keep these teachings close with a lot of integrity and a lot of deep care and love," Medina says. The story of Mary Ellen Pleasant, the civil rights heroine of Victorian San Francisco, by Carly Severn. Sometimes there's a character within a city's history who's so compelling you can't believe their name isn't on every street corner. 19th century civil rights icon and entrepreneur Mary Ellen Pleasant is one such figure in San Francisco legend. Although there is one place you'll find her name imprinted on the city streets, on a plaque set in the sidewalk at the corner of Bush and Octavia Streets in San Francisco's Pacific Heights neighborhood, where she once lived in a grand but now vanished mansion. The plaque reads, "Mother of Civil Rights in California." And yet, despite her myriad achievements commemorated on that plaque beneath the eucalyptus trees, this towering Bay Area figure remains, for many San Franciscans, a mystery. How can this be? Who was the real Mary Ellen Pleasant? Rather be a corpse than a coward. Her life is so enshrouded in mystery because she was her own spin doctor, said Sacramento writer and performer Sushil Bibbs, who has studied Pleasant's story for decades. Pleasant wrote three autobiographies, but each one contradicts the others on basic facts, such as the year of her birth. We do know that she was born into slavery in Georgia and was raised in Nantucket, Massachusetts, in indenture, said Bibbs. On the East Coast, the young Pleasant became a crucial figure in the civil rights fight, secretly teaming up with abolitionists and rescuing escaped enslaved people on the Underground Railroad. In this world, nothing could ever be as it seemed, and concealment, disguise, and duality were weapons in Pleasant's armory from the start. That double life included presenting as a white woman when she could. She was very used to being covert, said Bibbs. She often said that words were made to conceal feelings and that she was good at it. Early on, Pleasant married well and rich. And after her first husband died, Pleasant took the $45,000 in gold she now had from his estate and arrived by steamer in San Francisco in 1852, still passing as white. She found a town filled with men come to make their gold rush fortunes, far from home and in need of lodging, food, and domestic services. Pleasant invested her sizable wealth in property, establishing boarding houses and laundries, anything and everything she correctly thought would be a niche in San Francisco to make more money, said Bibbs. Pleasant deliberately stayed close to the action in the boarding houses she ran and later owned, learning a lot of the private details about the influential men who stayed there. She used them as another kind of currency, not just to rise in society, but also to further her real cause, bringing the Underground Railroad out west. While the wealthy white people of San Francisco society knew her as the white boarding house proprietress, San Francisco's growing black community knew her real identity. She was known as the Black City Hall, the place you could go to get what you needed, someone who helped black people get jobs on steamers, in white homes, and in her own businesses. Almost a century before Rosa Parks, she challenged San Francisco's segregated transit system in court, winning the right for black people to ride streetcars without being thrown off. "My cause," Pleasant wrote in one of her memoirs, "was the cause of freedom and equality for myself and for my people, and I'd rather be a corpse than a coward." After the Civil War, and more than a decade after she arrived in the city, Pleasant finally checked the box for black on the census of 1865. While this may have caused a stir among the wealthy white people who'd thought her one of their own, Pleasant continued to move in their circles. That tide, however, was about to turn, and a heroine soon became a villain in the eyes of white society. Queen of the Voodoos. By the 1880s, the wild and mud-caked San Francisco that Mary Ellen Pleasant, the capitalist, had carved her way into had itself transformed into a very much overtly racist city, said Sushil Bibbs. Across the nation, emancipated black people became convenient scapegoats for the economy's woes. As a wealthy, older black woman, Pleasant now inspired suspicion, even fear, in the white social circles she moved in. The press coined a nickname intended to diminish her power with the racist image it conjured, Mammy Pleasant. Unsurprisingly, she loathed it. "It gives me the suspirations," she wrote. She'd always been a figure of fascination in San Francisco, but now whispers spread that she had some otherworldly hold over the wealthy white people she was close to. People like Thomas Bell, her white business partner and friend, with whom she shared her vast mansion, along with Teresa, the wife she'd found for him. One headline in the San Francisco Call asked, "Mammy Pleasant, angel or archfiend in the house of mystery?" In 1883, Pleasant became entangled in the scandalous trial of Nevada Senator William Sharon, who was accused of seducing and then abandoning a young woman named Sarah Althea Hill. Bibbs describes the case as the O.J. Simpson trial of its day and how it captivated the press and public alike across the nation. Of course, Pleasant wasn't on trial herself, but she was the young Hill's friend. And lawyers for Sharon painted Pleasant as a sinister crone. They claimed she'd used dark forces to manipulate her friend into entrapping a senator. Yet rather than rejecting the rumors, Pleasant encouraged them, even during the senator's trial. She carried a voodoo doll in court, claiming she would use it to bring about his death. And die he did, before the trial ended. While her behavior might strike us now as self-defeating, Pleasant had always employed misdirection to confound expectations and control her narrative. Pleasant's public status as a voodoo queen grew, cementing her reputation as a quasi-mystical figure in San Francisco. To white people in the Bay Area, voodoo meant blood magic and malevolent intent. To Mary Ellen Pleasant, however, the real voodoo, voudon or voudon, was actually her religion from her ancestral homeland. She was born the daughter of a voodoo priestess and the granddaughter of a voodoo priestess from Haiti, explained Bibbs. Bibbs believes there's strong evidence to suggest that Pleasant had studied in New Orleans with legendary voudon practitioner Marie Laveau before coming to San Francisco, and learned particularly from Laveau's emphasis on using one's power to serve the community. Scandal followed scandal. When Pleasant's business partner, Thomas Bell, was found dead in her mansion, his widow, Teresa, collaborated on a full-page smear piece in the San Francisco Chronicle with the headline, "The Queen of the Voodoos." The press had used the language of the supernatural to describe Pleasant for years, but now they made her into a flat-out monster, accusing her of witchcraft and implying she murdered Bell. This article ignited a public wave against Mary Ellen Pleasant from the powers that be, for whom she'd become too powerful, too loud, almost diabolical, fueled by hate, revenge, and racism, said Bibbs. One could not tell who she was. It's telling who gets a legend and who gets a ghost story. Mary Ellen Pleasant was demonized in her own lifetime, yet in a system so loaded against Black women in the public eye, playing with rumor as she did was perhaps the only way to play the game, even if it was ultimately her undoing. Pleasant died in 1904 in her 90s, with her fortunes greatly diminished by scandal. Her obituary in the San Francisco Examiner was titled, "Mammy Pleasant Will Work Weird Spells No More." In her own writings, the widow Teresa Bell defined Pleasant as a demon from first to last. Learning the details of her extraordinary life, it's hard to fathom why Mary Ellen Pleasant isn't a towering figure in San Francisco history. From those newspapers to her early biographers, Pleasant's life has been so mangled to the extent that, as Bibbs put it, one could not tell who she was. How we're remembered depends on who's telling our stories. And one day, Mary Ellen Pleasant will get the recognition she deserves. Not in spite of her complexity, but because of it. Emperor Norton, America's Emperor, San Francisco's Treasure, by Ryan Levy. Emperor Norton is one of San Francisco's most beloved historical figures, occupying a space somewhere between reality and legend, punchline, and moral hero. While the self-proclaimed emperor didn't wield any real power, he held influence in Gold Rush-era San Francisco and has since endured as a symbol of its quirky spirit, boom or bust fortunes, and progressive values. But who was Emperor Norton really? How was he seen in his own time, and why is he still revered today? The Rise and Fall of a Gold Rush Businessman. Emperor Norton was born Joshua Abraham Norton in London in 1818. When he was 2 years old, his family moved to South Africa, where his father started a successful business selling shipbuilding supplies. Norton opened his own ship supply business when he was 21, but within 18 months, the business had failed. Looking for a new start, Norton arrived in San Francisco in late 1849. The gold rush had transformed a small town of a few hundred people into a bustling metropolis of 25,000 within a few years. People were making and losing their fortunes in the blink of an eye. Norton, who had already built and lost a business in South Africa, fit right in. He established himself as a successful businessman, selling commodities like rice and flour. He invested in real estate, building on some of the most lucrative plots in town. "He made a great amount of money and was very influential," said John Lumia, founder of the Emperor Norton Trust, which focuses on researching Norton's life and sharing it with the public. "He was in with all the right people, attended all the right clubs, and all the right restaurants." Riding high, Norton planned his next business move. With a rice famine underway in China, Norton tried to corner the market by buying a shipload of Peruvian rice. He expected rice prices to soar, but it all went wrong. Within a few days, ship after ship after ship of rice comes in, and so the bottom falls out of the market, Lumia said. This idea, which at one point seemed so great, now isn't so great. The deal ruined Norton, and by the time he was 38, he had gone bankrupt for a second time. An imperial transformation. After his business failures, Norton went quiet for a few years. He moved out of his luxurious home and fell out of favor with some members of the social elite. He reemerged on September 17, 1859, on the pages of the San Francisco Evening Bulletin newspaper. Earlier in the day, he had walked into the paper's offices and presented the editor with a short notice he asked to have published. The notice read, "At the peremptory request of a large majority of the citizens of these United States, I, Joshua Norton, formerly of Algoa Bay, Cape of Good Hope, and now for the last 9 years and 10 months past of San Francisco, California, declare and proclaim myself Emperor of these United States." 3 years after losing everything, Norton christened himself Emperor of the United States. In the wake of Napoleon III's invasion of Mexico, Norton added Protector of Mexico to his imperial title in 1863. There are no sure answers about Norton's mental health before or after his imperial declaration, but some people think his money troubles led him into a deep depression, and that becoming Emperor Norton was a coping mechanism. There's a sense in which the persona of the emperor actually saved him in a way, John Lumia said. In his first proclamation, Norton called on representatives of all U.S. states to assemble the following February to establish his empire and to ameliorate the evils under which the country is laboring. When February rolled around, nobody showed up. But that didn't stop Norton. He had declared himself emperor and would act like it for the next 20 years. Emperor of the United States, Protector of Mexico. Norton continued issuing imperial proclamations in the local newspapers. Some of his ideas were big, like calling for the end of presidential elections, while others read as personal grievances, such as when he chastised the skating rink operator who wouldn't let him use a pair of skates. Even though he went by Emperor of the United States, his proclamations were often very local in nature. He didn't hesitate to call out San Francisco's police and elected officials if he sensed corruption taking place. He supported a woman's right to vote. He advocated for fair treatment of immigrants by the courts. Perhaps his most well-known proclamations called for the construction of a bridge connecting Oakland and San Francisco, what we recognize today as the Bay Bridge. Norton also adopted an imperial wardrobe. He started with either a blue or gray military jacket, switching between the two to maintain his neutrality in the ongoing Civil War. After the war, he settled on a blue officer's jacket, furnished with large, fringe, golden shoulder epaulets. His balding head was almost always covered with a hat, most often a small military capy or a garish beaver fur top hat, with a cascade of colorful feathers pinned to the front. Being emperor did not pay very well. Norton spent most of his reign subsiding on the generosity of the public and the support of a few wealthy friends from his high society days. But he didn't need much money. His lodgings cost only 50 cents a night, and and he spent most of his day reading the newspapers, socializing in Portsmouth Square, and writing proclamations at the Mechanics Institute Library on Post Street. For lunch, Norton could go to almost any tavern in town, and for the price of a drink, no more than 25 cents, get access to a full lunch spread. "He really makes himself part of the life of the city," John Lumia said. "He goes to political meetings. He goes to the theater. He goes to the saloons. He makes himself a public presence." For the most part, San Franciscans embraced Norton's eccentricities. Theaters would even reserve their best seats for the emperor on opening nights, and shops sold emperor figurines. To the city's newspapers, however, Norton was a bit of a buffoon, and they regularly published fake proclamations with his name attached. In 1870, he started publishing his genuine proclamations almost exclusively in the African-American-owned and operated abolitionist weekly, The Pacific Appeal. Many of Norton's proclamations were progressive for his time. He's talking about how African-Americans should have the right to attend public schools, ride public streetcars, how the Chinese should be able to have their testimony heard in court, Lumia said. Norton also argued for the rights of Native Americans and against political corruption. So he is really making himself into an early champion of the values of fairness and tolerance and the common good that really later became a great symbol of San Francisco.
Lura et mort.
January 8, 1880 was a cold and rainy night in San Francisco. Norton left his room on Commercial Street to walk the few short blocks to a debate at the Academy of Natural Sciences. On his way there, he collapsed on California Street and died of a suspected stroke. Days later, a headline in the San Francisco Chronicle read, "Lura et mort, the king is dead." 10,000 people reportedly came to his funeral. Though Norton died with just a few dollars in his pocket, his old friends in business paid for a fancy rosewood coffin adorned with silver and a burial plot in the Masonic Cemetery. Even though often in the official world of journalism or politics he was somewhat seen as a figure of ridicule, John Lumia said, to the people in the streets who saw him on a day-to-day basis for 20 years, he was known as a very kind person. More than 140 years after his death, Norton continues to captivate the imaginations of San Franciscans who still flock to his grave, which has since been moved to Colma. For many people, he represents the best of the Bay Area, an advocate of fairness and tolerance, a kind person, and a bit of an oddball. The Bay Area's Hollywood: How Charlie Chaplin and Silent Films Flourished in the East Bay, by Rachel Miro. When you think of movie making in California, your mind may conjure up images of Hollywood, with its big studio lots and glamorous stars. But there's another spot in the Golden State that played a pivotal role in cinematic history, a small town in the East Bay called Niles. When movies moved in. In the early 20th century, before Niles became a Fremont neighborhood, it used to be its own town, with sunny, warm weather more akin to that in Southern California, and easy access by train to San Francisco and Chicago. That all had tremendous appeal for the S&A Film Manufacturing Company, run in part by Gilbert M. Bronco Billy Anderson, the first Western movie star cowboy. Anderson had been traveling around the United States for 3 years, looking for the perfect weather and filming location for the Westerns that he was making, explained David Keene, historian for the Niles S&A Silent Film Museum. Anderson settled on Niles in April of 1912, and over the next 4 years, S&A made more than 350 films there. "It was the most successful silent film company in the Bay Area," said Keene. Fast and Furious. Film companies of the time churned out movies at the rate of several a week. They tended to be thin on plot and big on action, especially chase scenes and slapstick comedy. The companies hired a lot of actors from the world of vaudeville theater, who had the physical stamina and comedic chops for this kind of work. Bronco Billy spotted a rising talent at a rival film company in Hollywood, a young English comedian by the name of Charles Chaplin. Chaplin had been working at the Keystone Film Company for $150 a week, and his contract was almost up. They signed him at SNA for $1,250 a week and a $10,000 signing bonus, said Keane. It was an expensive bet that paid off for SNA. Chaplin didn't particularly like Niles, which was, after all, a bit of a backwater compared to Los Angeles, but he made five films in Niles that cemented his standing as a movie star. One of those was The Tramp. You can still visit the locations where the scenes were shot. For instance, consider the final iconic scene, when the broken-hearted tramp waddles away from the camera in Niles Canyon. The area still looks a lot like it did back then, with big trees waving over a winding country road, albeit paved now. SNA allowed Chaplin to transition from being an ensemble performer with popular bits in someone else's films to a filmmaker himself, exercising creative control with great autonomy. Niles is pivotal, said film history expert Mark Wanamaker. He could do whatever he wanted. This was the beginning of Chaplin as we know him. Chaplin itched to return to Hollywood, though, which by then was well on its way to becoming the center of the movie-making universe. There, Chaplin made a few more movies for the company before striking out on his own as a producer. The Niles studio closed in February 1916 and was ultimately torn down in 1933. By then, talkies had become popular, and the studio's proximity to loud train tracks was an insurmountable problem. The silent film era lasted almost 40 years, from the 1890s through the 1920s. It's amazing how many films were made in that time period. Thousands and thousands of films. Only a fraction survive, but because there were so many made, there are still a lot of them around, said Keane. Today, the Niles SNA Silent Film Museum lives on as a temple to silent films. It boasts an impressive and ever-growing archive of silent movies that were filmed not just in Niles, but all over the world. People regularly send in old footage to the museum, knowing it's a safe place to keep it. Keane repairs and researches the footage, bringing it back to life. It's amazing what's out there and still turning up, he said. A family recently came to him with footage from the aftermath of the San Francisco earthquake in 1906. Some pretty amazing stuff, he said. Movies set in the Bay Area. The gorgeous hills, golden light, and stunning architecture have made the Bay Area an ideal backdrop for many movies over the years. A few favorites on our short list. We'll start with the classics. Vertigo, 1958. If you're going to watch one movie set in San Francisco, it should be this Alfred Hitchcock psychological thriller, considered by many critics to be one of the greatest films ever made. In the film, a police officer turned personal investigator becomes obsessed with a woman he's been hired to tail. It features shots of Coit Tower, the Palace of Fine Arts, the Golden Gate Bridge, and more. If you want to see the city's biggest attractions, this film is a hit parade of gorgeous locations. Bullet, 1968. Do we need to say much more than epic car chase scenes on San Francisco's hills? This Steve McQueen action thriller features tons of on-location filming, so you'll get a big taste of the city. Cars fly, skid, and smoke as they race around the streets of North Beach and Potrero Hill. In the background, you'll peep the downtown San Francisco skyline, the blue of Bay Waters, Angel Island, and Coit Tower. The Joy Luck Club, 1993. Have a box of tissues nearby for this emotional film that explores the relationships between Chinese immigrant mothers and their Americanized daughters. Based on the book of the same name by Oakland-born Amy Tan, it's celebrated for its all-Asian cast and nuanced portrayal of the Chinese immigrant experience. Filming took place in Richmond, San Francisco, and Filoli Estate in Woodside. Next, the social commentary category. The Last Black Man in San Francisco, 2019. This wasn't just filmed in San Francisco, it's also a commentary on how gentrification decimated once vibrant black neighborhoods in the Bay Area. The story follows Jimmy Fails as he tries to reclaim the Victorian home his grandfather built, and with it, his sense of belonging in a city that has changed. The cinematography will absolutely take your breath away, featuring warm shots of a classic Victorian and everyday city life on San Francisco streets. Inside Out, 2015. Pixar Animation Studios is based in Emeryville and has dropped Bay Area references in several animated films over the years, but Inside Out takes it to the next level. You'll find animated versions of the Golden Gate Bridge, an interior of a Victorian home, San Francisco's Ferry Building, and a pizza place based on Berkeley's Cheese Board Collective. The movie highlights the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.